to our shipyard for the launching of the future USS Little Rock. It is a privilege for Fincantieri, me and my family, to be part of this ceremony, and more importantly, to have been honored and trusted to build these ships for the world's most successful and demanding navy. This is the first ship we have built in the littoral combat ship series for the US Navy. It established magnets ever-growing importance in the shipbuilding industrial base of this country, and reinforces further the connection between Fincantieri, the largest shipbuilder in the Western world, and the United States, the world's premier maritime nation. This is a one century old bond that goes back to the early 20th century, when Fincantieri, designers and engineers, traveled to Philadelphia to support the early development of the US Navy submarine fleet. Over the past 100 years, this relationship has grown to the point where the US has now become Fincantieri's most valued business partner. As in an average year, US customers, both private and the government, account for over one third of our revenues. This strong relationship is grounded on the recognition of Fincantieri's ability to apply technical and process innovation to building ships efficiently and effectively. We are immensely grateful for the trust that the United States continues to put in Fincantieri. There are three ways in which Fincantieri responds to the trust placed in us: investing, improving, and innovating. First, we have invested hundreds of millions to establish Fincantieri Marine Group and grow the capabilities of the US shipyards. Today, there are 7 LCS ships here, and I think it's a world record. At Fincantieri Marinette Marine, an incredible increase from just 4 years ago. Second, we strive daily to improve the manufacturing processes and the know-how of our most important asset, our people. Fincantieri has shared significant technology, shipbuilding know-how and resources to supplement our US-based operations and the talent. We have added over 900 people to our workforce, and the studies prove this means a total of almost 5,000 new jobs in the area. We remain committed to continue investing where outcomes can be profitable and beneficial for all parties. Third, we innovate continuously in technologies, solutions, and tools to modernize shipbuilding. We design ships that are ever more green and connected while providing the modularity and the flexibility to adapt to changing missions. A prime example is the recent award for the renewal of the Italian fleet, new Navy fleet, to control the unsafe and dangerous migratory flows in the Mediterranean Sea, while being ready to deal with the other regional security threats. Looking at the future, discussions are taking place regarding the shape of the LCS program, the Fast Frigate, and America's approach to the international naval markets with an affordable and combat-capable vessel. We, with our partners, are ready to take these programs further in the way that best meets the needs of the mission, the needs of the nation for today and tomorrow. In fact, we are proud to not just build ships, but to help in building America for the rest of the 21st century. We look forward to continuing to do this together with our partners, our workers, our customers, and the communities that support us. As from the G4 submarine in Philadelphia to this LCS Little Rock in Marinette, a strong bond has been forged between Ficantieri and America. We remain committed to perpetuate this bond into the future and make it ever stronger. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bono. It's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, who has been with this program since 2006. I really don't have to say much about him. You already know him. Joe North, Vice President, Lockheed Martin, Littoral Combat Ship Systems.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for bearing with the weather. And we continue to do our just-in-time with clear weather and sun. If Mr. Secretary, you can admit this is true. It seems to happen a little less than an hour before the event, so we've done it once again. And I think the entire platform is taking credit this time. So thank you, Dan. Thank you, Mrs. Bonner, Senator Baldwin, Secretary Mabus, and everyone who has joined us today. I'm truly honored to be part of the exciting occasion. The christening and launch of the Little Rock will give this ship her identity as she moves another step towards serving the U.S. Navy and our nation. In the past decade, we have seen countless accomplishments in this program. The ship displayed behind me is another milestone that is a tribute to the strong industry team and to our suppliers. And on behalf of Lockheed Martin and all the men and women, Fincantieri Marine and all their men and women, Gibbs & Cox, their men and women, and the strong industry partners that are out there today and those watching, hopefully on our live stream, I'd like a round of applause to all the folks that have done a lot of hard work to put this ship together and get it to where she is today. We absolutely would not be here without the dedication of those folks and that team. USS Freedom completed a successful deployment to Southeast Asia, where she participated in multinational exercises, completed patrols, and offered humanitarian aid. Fort Worth is currently in the midst of a 16-month deployment and has done exceptionally well. Each ship that comes out of here is improved over the one before it, a testament to what the team can do and we're committed to. Like Freedom, Fort Worth has participated also in several multinational exercises while providing the forward presence to America's allies that the Navy deems so very important. As the team that builds and delivers these ships to continue to the fleet, we know that every one of our follow-on ships will continue to serve the Navy with the same distinction for many years to come. Currently, there are seven Freedom-class ships being built in various stages in this shipyard today. Fincantieri Marinette Marine stands by their commitment and is doing a great job with the investment that you see, with the employment which has doubled since the beginning of this program, and stays committed to what we need to bring these ships to the fleet on the schedule that they need them. We were also awarded two additional ships, LCS 21 and 23, this past March, and there's an option for another hull, LCS 25, in 2016. exhibiting the confidence the U.S. Navy has in this team. But today we're here to celebrate the future USS Little Rock. Little Rock has roots in Navy history, and this littoral combat ship will be the second Navy ship to pay tribute to that very proud city. The first Little Rock, a Cleveland-class light cruiser when she was built, was later converted to a guided missile cruiser, again, showing the early start of the adaptability, flexibility, and modularity that we have. Proudly serving her was our very own Navy Secretary Mavis, who was a surface warfare officer on the original USS Little Rock. Mr. Secretary, we thank you for your service as well as for your very strong and vocal support for this program. The future USS Little Rock will be unlike the original namesake in terms of missions and capabilities. She will reach speeds of up to 45 knots. She will use interchangeable mission modules that empower her to face a variety of high-priority missions, from anti-surface warfare to anti-submarine warfare to mine countermeasures. And she will also enter waters other Navy combat ships are unable to go. With her shallow draft, just 13 feet, the Little Rock is ideally suited to navigate the reefs and shallows of the Asia-Pacific, as well demonstrated by the USS Fort Worth on her current deployment. Our sailors will strengthen the force of LCS as they take her into harm's way to defeat the threats in the littorals. We are proud to support the current and future crews of Little Rock, who will defend our maritime interests at home and abroad. So let me end again expressing my appreciation to you, Mrs. Bonner, and to all those who have brought us to this point with your very hard work. Effort, dedication to the program is always there. Thank you to the entire industry team, and thank you to the U.S. Navy for your trust in this team's ability to bring Little Rock to the fleet. Thank you.
Our next speaker is our boss, Rear Admiral Brian Antonio. Admiral Antonio has been a driving force behind this program's acquisition since the beginning. His guidance and direction have been timely to us and to all of the teammates as we went forward. We're lucky to have a strong leader like him, somebody who's personally involved in the program, and I gotta tell you, it's an admiral that really cares about what he does. So please welcome Admiral Brian Antonio.
Mrs. Bonner, Secretary Mavis, Senator Baldwin, Congressman Ribble, Mayor Stodola, Vice Admiral Malloy, Secretary Winter, Mrs. Linda Winter, new president of the Society of Sponsors, distinguished guests and visitors, good morning. As Dan mentioned, it's a great Navy day, and of course, judging by the turnout and the way the weather is turning, it's getting better all the time. You'll be hearing from a number of esteemed speakers this morning, which is, I take as a sign of the ever-growing support of these fine ships at all levels of government, and of course of the positive momentum that we continue to achieve in the LCS program. I talk a lot about the positive momentum, but what does it really mean? Being a career naval officer, I often think in terms of a standard Navy tour of duty, or about 3 years. So let's talk about that. By 2018, or within one tour of duty, we'll have not just one LCS operating out of Singapore, but four. Each of the mission packages that Joe North just mentioned, the mine countermeasure mission package, the anti-submarine warfare mission package, and the surface warfare mission package, will have all achieved their initial operating capability. And by 2018, we will have completed the full ship shock trials for both variants of LCS. Fourth, the last three ships of the current LCS design, hulls number 30 through 32, will be funded, of course, with the help of Senator Baldwin and Congressman Ribble. And we will have a request for proposal to industry for the new frigates. And finally, this may come as a shock to some observers, by 2018, LCS will constitute the second largest surface ship class of ships in the Navy, only behind the DDG-51 class. Now that's what I call momentum. As head of the Navy organization responsible for design, development, procurement, testing, and delivery of the littoral combat ships and their mission packages, I'm in a unique position to see what works and what doesn't. Every challenge presents an opportunity, something I tell my folks every day. And make no mistake, the team that is bringing LCS to the fleet excels at turning challenges into opportunities. From our industry partners at Lockheed Martin to Fincantieri's Marinette Marine Shipbuilders and their suppliers, to the dedicated men and women, many of whom are with us this morning, who bring this ship nearer to completion every day. From the LCS program manager, Captain Tom Anderson, and his superb staff, to the supervisor of shipbuilding in Bath, Maine, Captain Mike Taylor, the program manager's representative, Commander Nate Schneider, and the rest of the outstanding supervisor of shipbuilding team here in Marinette. And let's not forget Little Rock's impressive pre-commissioning crews led by Commander Kevin Ralston and Commander Paul Burkhart. I know what a special day this is for you, and I have no doubt that as Mrs. Bonner christens this warship, you will take her gracious spirit to heart as you proudly serve our Navy, your nation, and one another. In closing, may God bless Little Rock, her crew, our Navy, and our nation. Go Navy, go LCS.
Thank you, Admiral. Our next speaker is the Honorable Mark Stoda, Mayor of our namesake city, Little Rock. It's my opportunity to introduce someone that is infectious in his belief in this ship. He's excited about this, and the 200,000 patriots in Little Rock are reaching out to you today. This reestablishes your naval history. Mayor.
Thank you very much. Secretary Mabus, Mrs. Bonner, Vice Admiral Malloy, Rear Admiral Antonio, Senator Baldwin, Representative Ribble, and distinguished guests, I am so honored to be here on behalf of those 200,000 people in the city of Little Rock as we receive the honor of having this ship named after our great city. There have been many important ships throughout American history, and I am proud that we can once again include the USS Little Rock among them, the most advanced, sophisticated, and agile combat ship in the Navy. I'm very proud that my senior senator from Arkansas, Senator John Bozeman, is with us today. Thank you, sir, for being with us. You know, Little Rock is the capital city of Arkansas, and it's located on the Arkansas River, one of our nation's great inland waterways. Little Rock was named for a stone outcropping on the banks of the Arkansas River that was used by travelers as a landmark before we became a country. In 1722, the French explorer Bernard de la Harpe named the area La Petite Roche, French for the Little Rock. And about 4 years ago, in October of 2011, I had the distinct honor to stand on the banks of the Arkansas River at the Little Rock with Secretary Mabus when he announced the naming of LCS-9 as the USS Little Rock. In the mast-stepping ceremony yesterday, I placed a Little Rock in the canister so that wherever the USS Little Rock travels around the world, there will always be a piece of the rock aboard. As you know, and has been mentioned, Secretary Mabus served as an officer aboard the original USS Little Rock, and I know that he has a lifetime of memories from his time aboard that ship. And I'm so honored that Secretary Mabus and the U.S. Navy saw fit to name another ship after our city. And so, as the first USS Little Rock had an honorable and distinguished career protecting our country and had a Secretary of the Navy as a future officer, I can only hope that this USS Little Rock and its officers and sailors will have such a distinguished and honorable career protecting our country and protecting freedom around the world. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Vice Admiral Joseph Malloy, Deputy CNO for Integration Capabilities and Resources. This means that he controls all the money in the Pentagon, certainly on shipbuilding money, and we're very happy to have him with us. Sir, this wouldn't be possible without you.
Well, Dan, thank you very much for that kind introduction. Secretary Mabus, Secretary Winter, other distinguished guests here, and the group is so large, but I especially want to reach out to the tremendous number of shipyard workers and families. This is a family day, and I'll talk more about my experience of new construction and why this means so much to me. But on behalf of the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral John Greenert, I bring you greetings from the Pentagon, and I'm very lucky to get away. Unlike our Secretary, who was able to travel from the Pentagon and see many people, I don't get out very much without his permission. Because he said was, for 6 years I've served this man as the programmer for the Navy, the budget officer for the Department of Navy, and now the head of resources. It's my job to find a good deal. And that's what I do around here. And I will tell you, having visited the shipyard and visited the shipyard workers and this whole leadership team, I have found a good deal for the Navy, Mr. Secretary, and we need to keep buying these ships. Thank you all very much. It's a beautiful day in Wisconsin. My wife is from Green Bay and my brother-in-law, and she talked about being up here and about the lovely weather, and she talked about the winter. And so I have smartly followed up one time to at least visit the yard, and I'll come back in the wintertime. But as I was driving up Route 43 on Thursday and coming up, and I saw Lambeau Field in the distance, so I contacted my brother-in-law, and I said, hey, I can see it. It's right here like you talked about. He said, did you stop and genuflect? I said, Steve, you know I'm Catholic, and you know I genuflect. It's a football stadium. He said, no, Joe, it's a shrine. So now I really do understand Midwest football, because now I've seen Lambeau Field, and I've been at Notre Dame. So clearly what we need to get around here is the touchdown Jesus in downtown Green Bay, and you have it all. So it's a wonderful occasion to be here in the Marionette Menominee area, and like I said, it brings back family connections as well as a Navy connection to me in terms of shipyards. I love shipyards, and this is a magnificent place. It's a fantastic investment by the companies that came here, but it's a real testimony to the workforce. And I want to tell the family members of the workers here and the subcontractors, you should be so proud of what your mothers and fathers do on this yard day in and day out. The quality of the work, the focus on delivery, overcoming whatever the weather throws at you, but building a fantastic set of ships. And touring yesterday, I covered 8 hours and 5 miles of walking with this the Gus Leader, the president of the company here, and it's magnificent. Wherever we went is high tech, but big hearts. And that's what really makes shipbuilding work, is the big hearts of the people, the brains, the engagement, the techniques, and just the love of shipbuilding, which is really, really resonant in this area. And I can tell why Great Lakes Shipbuilding has been a part of the Navy for a long, long time, and it will be a part of the Navy for a long, long time. The precision and care put in design and the construction of the ship. Thank you. So, the precision and care and time put in the design and construction of the ship show the commitment of Fincantieri, Marriott Marine, Lockheed Martin, and all the people who touched the ship and brought Little Rock to this point. On behalf of our CNO, I would like to thank you all and all the people here. One day I can clearly say and see is that this shipyard workers are like family, but also family legacies. I met a large number of people that are their second and third generations of working here, and that's important, and that's what I've seen in other shipyards, but it really resonates here. In many ways, the ship and the crew that we just saw brought up here is like a family. The strength of the ship is not just the reliance on the steel and the hull, but the bond of the crew. A crew supports each other, they grow together, and can be counted on to support their commanding officer. Today's event is one of the reasons why I love the Navy and its extended family. I think many of you do too. It is the ebb and flow of our tradition that is bound up in our busy days. It gives us something to hold on to cherish, to feel we are part of bigger than something than ourselves, and we're making America a little bit better every day. Earlier events in the life of the ship, such as the contracting between NAVC and Admiral Antonio and the companies, and the initial fabrication of the hull, bound the Navy and the shipbuilder together on the path leading to today. The keel laying a few years ago introduced a sponsor who will love the ship as much or more than the builder and her crew into this special dance of life that only the Navy, the society of our ship sponsors, and our wonderful shipbuilders know and love. The next major step in this construction process is today's event, which will now cement forever the sponsor, the builder, the Navy, the crew, and the spirit of the namesake city into a special bond that will last for decades. I'm a nuclear-trained officer, and that's my background. We believe in procedures. We understand the technology we love and work with. But as a result, we also believe in instructions and how things are done properly. And there's instruction. Obviously, in the Navy, there would be one that talks about today's events. It's SecNav Instruction 5031.1C. It is on christening and commissioning, and it specifically states, the christening ceremony marks the traditional transition of the ship from new construction phase to its more comprehensive tests and trials phase, moving from a mere hull number to a ship with a name and a spirit. To me, the christening is the beginning of a ship's life. I know and understand the ceremony. I was a new construction engineer officer on the USS Miami back in 1990 when it was christened at Electric Boat. I remember the deep, proud feelings I felt and the profound effect the ceremony had on our crew, our family, the audience, and the sponsor as we slid into the river. The memory is as clear to me as it was yesterday. That is how significant this ceremony is. It will induce pride and ownership of this crew in this great ship. It will leave a lasting impression on their lives, the Navy, and everyone in this audience. This will be the beginning of the Little Rock way, on how to run and love and take care of their ship, and on their sponsor, and they will also know their sponsor will be with them every day. We need Little Rock, and we need her way out in the fleet. Our LCS in the fleet have been very successful, as a couple of you have pointed out here, and have wet the whistles of our combatant commanders for more hulls. The flexibility of this class has been clearly shown by Fort Worth on her full range of missions, everything from high-end war games and simulations off operating with our allies in Korea, operating with our fleet off of Japan, but especially in operations off Indonesia with a partner in Southeast Asia. At the tragedy of the Air Asia crash, there was the USS Pinckney, a $2 billion destroyer there, a wonderful ship, an amazing capability, ballistic missile defense, integrated missile defense. It brought a lot to bear. But what was the ship, the 7th Fleet, and what did the 7th Fleet and Pacific Command really want? They wanted the Fort Worth. Why? Because they flew out a mobile diving and salvage unit on short notice to contain the flexibility and modularity of the ship to bring on equipment, divers, and then to operate in shallow water near Indonesian islands made a tremendous difference, such that this ship, at one-third the cost, was able to provide twice the mission of what was needed at that point. And that's what we need in the toolkit of our Navy. We have 280 ships, we want to be over 300. We need flexible tools, just like in the buildings around you see here, you have to have the right tool for the right mission to build the right part of the ship. Well, every ship has its mission in the fleet, and this ship has its mission in the future, and we need to get it out there. I'll leave you with two quotes that I learned 40 years ago during my plebe year at the Naval Academy. And the first talks about the importance of navies to countries is recognized by a great statesman. It's really understood by countries like Italy, Great Britain, and the United States that have a naval tradition that is bound up in how important it is to who we are. It follows then, as certain as the night succeeds the day, that without a decisive naval force, we can do nothing definitive, and with it, everything honorable and glorious. George Washington, President of the United States. I also point out, was also a 4-star general in the Army, but he still loved the Navy. The second is a charge to the crew, and it comes from Commodore Stephen Decatur, our victor in many of our 19th century naval battles, in the War of 1812, and our Barbary Wars. This goes right to the commanding officers and the crew on the ship as I look at them. Personal courage, obedience to order, and endurance under stress are the qualifiers of a good seaman. Thank you all very much. May God bless Little Rock, her captains, her crew, her sponsor, her builders, our Navy, and our nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Admiral. Our next speaker is the Honorable Reed Ribble, representing Wisconsin's 8th District. Congressman Ribble serves on the Committee on Foreign Affairs, Transportation Infrastructure Committee. He's worked diligently in the House representing LCS. We're very privileged to have a congressman like Congressman Reed Ribble.
Good morning, everybody. And Senator Bozeman, it's a real treat to have you here in Wisconsin with us today. For those of you who don't know, Senator Bozeman and I share a meal every Tuesday night, and it's an honor to have you with us this morning. It's good to see you. I think I have been asked dozens of times why I support and so strongly support the LCS program. And I think it's easy for us as Americans, when we think of our Navy, to think of things like what happened at Pearl Harbor and then the American response at Midway. It's easy to think about the bombardment at Iwo Jima and Normandy and the landing there. It's easy for us to think of great military battles and victories. But all those things, as important as they are not the reason that I support the LCS. I think they are important. And to the shipbuilders that are here, the men and women who actually craft this fine vessel, you've built a vessel that can destroy and defend America, destroy and defend. But you've also built a vessel that can rescue and save. And when I think of the purpose of the Navy, I think it goes beyond Midway. I think of Haiti and a U.S. naval vessel off the coast of Haiti after an earthquake. I think of the citizens of the Philippines after a typhoon and our Navy comes in to rescue. I think of the purpose, the peaceful purpose, of the United States Navy off the coast of Southeast Asia after a tsunami killed 250,000 people. I'll never forget seeing the photo, I think it was in Time magazine, one of our young Marines carrying a two-year-old injured child after the tsunami that hit Southeast Asia, and walking next to this Marine as he was carrying this child to go aboard a Navy vessel to get medical aid was the young boy's father wearing an Osama bin Laden t-shirt. It would have been very easy for this Marine to focus on the father in the t-shirt, but chose instead to focus on the child. This is the heart and compassion of America. And when I think of the LCS, I think of its close-in, shallow-water capability that can provide that very peaceful purpose around the globe. It is so important for us and so important for America that the world see not only our ability to defend ourselves, but our ability to provide a peaceful purpose around the globe. They see in you, to the men and women standing in back who built the Little Rock, they see in you the great heart, the compassion, the charity and generosity of every single American that reaches out for peace around the globe. And this ship will represent that around the globe as well as defend and possibly be called to destroy. And that is such a higher calling and such a higher mission. And Admiral and Secretary Mavis, it is this peaceful purpose that drives me to defend this program and to defend the workers who build her. Because that is the very best of America. That is at the core who we are. And I will continue to defend that program in the Congress of the United States because of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congressman. Our next speaker is the Honorable Tammy Baldwin, United States Senator for Wisconsin. She's a member of the Senate Budget Committee and Senate Committee on Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs. Senator Baldwin's no stranger to this yard. She's been here, this is her third trip this year. She's been a strong and passionate supporter of this program. If you want to get a sense of her commitment, engage her in conversation. Our Senator, Senator Tammy Baldwin.
Good morning, everybody. And for those of you who are traveling from out of state, whether across the river in Michigan or across the nation from Alabama, from Arkansas, from Washington, D.C., welcome to Wisconsin. It is so great to be back here at Marinette Marine, and I couldn't be more honored than to join Congressman Ribble, Secretary Mabus, and everyone here today for this christening and launch ceremony. I have the great pleasure of serving a state where we have a long and very proud tradition of making things. That's what we do. Our made-in-Wisconsin manufacturing economy has sustained our prosperity for generations. In the case of Wisconsin's shipbuilding industry, our workers have also helped sustain America's security for generations, boasting a successful history of building ships for our nation's defense. The Littoral Combat Ship plays a critical role in continuing that tradition, providing the Navy with enhanced capabilities and flexibility at and affordable price. We gather at a critical time for the Navy and for America's national security strategy. The United States faces a dynamic and increasingly challenging threat environment. While budgets here at home continue to be constrained. And that means it's vital that the Navy buy ships that correctly balance warfighting capability and cost. When you look at the numerous recent successes of the Freedom variant ships while deployed, it is clear that the littoral combat ship meets those criteria. So I am extremely proud to represent the talented Wisconsin workers who build the LCS and support the dedicated men and women of the United States military. The LCS is not only essential to America's national security, it's also a critical part of Wisconsin's economy. During my time in the United States Senate, I've worked across party lines and fought for this important defense program because it employs thousands of hardworking Wisconsinites and positively impacts not only the local community, but has a ripple effect across our entire state, supporting Wisconsin jobs at nearly 100 Wisconsin businesses that are supplying parts to build the LCS here in Marinette. The LCS also has a tremendous economic impact down south, particularly in Alabama, making it especially fitting that Mrs. Janae Bonner has been chosen by Secretary Mabus as the sponsor of LCS 9, the future Little Rock. Throughout his tenure in the House, Janae's husband and my former colleague, Congressman Bonner, was a strong champion for the LCS program. And it's great to see that longtime support represented so well by the Bonner family here today. I look forward to continuing my work in support of the LCS program because it strengthens both our national security and our Made in America economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. I'm privileged to introduce our principal speaker, a former surface warfare officer. Don't get to do that too often. But he's also our 75th Secretary of the Navy and Marine Corps. Mr. Secretary, during your tour, you have been a shipbuilding secretary. You've redefined Navy shipbuilding and have significantly increased the number of ships in the fleet. Your enthusiasm for this program is tangible, and each time you visit this shipyard, it fills this shipyard with a sense of energy, purpose and pride, sir. Thank you for coming. Since your first visit back in 2011, the facility here at MMC has changed dramatically. It's a world-class shipbuilding operation with Fincantieri and Marinette Marine working together, and it's an incredible workforce you see in front of you today. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our 75th Secretary of the Navy, the Honorable Ray Mabus.
This is a happy day, and I want this to be a happy occasion, but I do want to pause just for a moment, as we did at the beginning of the ceremony. We lost 4 Marines and 1 sailor in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And it underscores just how dangerous the job we ask our sailors and Marines, our soldiers, our airmen, our Coast Guardsmen to do, regardless of where they are, regardless of whether they're forward deployed or not. We expect them to go in harm's way. It is always a risk to call out people because you're going to leave out somebody. But I'm going to make an exception to that political rule not to do it, because there are some people that I want to give some special recognition to, and there are many, many distinguished visitors that I won't get to. But starting on the platform, Mr. Mayor, thank you for being here. Whoop, wrong way. Dr. Bono, thank you. To my colleague, Joe Malloy. Joe pointed out that we've been together for 6 years. Joe didn't have a single gray hair when I met him. Joe's the money guy and has been since the word go. And he does such an outstanding job that we keep promoting him. But every time I issue guidance before the budget is developed, and there are certain areas that I say, we're not touching these areas. If we've got to find money, and we always do, don't go here. But one of Joe's jobs is to come up with alternatives. We call them in the military COAs, courses of action. And every time one of those COAs is, we can build fewer ships. So the last time we met, Joe had a long presentation, and he started in. I said, you know, before you even start, we're not taking any ships. So Joe takes a big slug of Malox, says aye, and finds the money. Bravo, Zulu Joe. Congressman, thank you for that eloquent explanation of our Navy and our nation. I've never heard it stated better. Rear Admiral, thank you for spearheading this program. Senator, I met Senator Baldwin just a few weeks after she was sworn in as a brand new senator. And we talked about LCS, and she has been a true champion, as has the congressman, of that. So thank you for representing your constituents, both of you, and America so well. There's another senator in the audience, Senator Bozeman from Arkansas. Thank you so much for being here today. There are two former governors, and actually there are three former governors here. Since I'm one of those too. But Jim Doyle, Jennifer Granto, Wisconsin and Michigan. Now it's in governor's DNA to worry about jobs, to make sure that the people that they represent have good jobs, high paying jobs, are fully employed, highly skilled. And they did that magnificently while they were governor. What is unusual, though, is they've been out of office for several years. They are still working for the people of Wisconsin, the people of Michigan, on this program. I have seen them more as former governors than I saw them as sitting governors. And so thank you. Y'all give these two governors a hand. To my predecessor, Don Winter, who is here today in a staff role, a support role to his wife, the new president of the Society of Sponsors. There is a certain justice in that, and I know that I will find that out when my wife christens the Triple E, which she is the sponsor. To the first person I met in the Pentagon as a nominee for this job, Robert Rangel, who helped me understand the job and helped me understand how that interesting place works. And finally, to my fellow sailors, from the first, USS Little Rock. particularly Master Chief Musselbaugh. The very first person I met on Little Rock when he was a young yeoman, and I was the most dangerous thing in the U.S. Navy, a junior officer coming on board my first ship. And it's been great to reconnect with the Master Chief. The importance of the Navy is enshrined in our Constitution. Article 1 says that Congress has the ability to raise an army, but it has the responsibility to maintain a Navy. And in that not so subtle distinction is the importance of our Navy and our Marine Corps. What we uniquely give this nation is presence. Being where it counts when it counts. Being in the right place, not just at the right time, but all the time. That presence reassures allies. It deters potential foes. It responds, as the Congressman said, to natural disasters. It can do everything from high-end warfare to hybrid warfare to the low-intensity conflicts that we're increasingly in today. But it can also help train other navies. It can respond to natural disasters. It can give humanitarian relief, disaster assistance. We get that presence. I'm going to talk a little bit about Navy 101 here, and then I'll get to Little Rock. We get that presence through four other things that start with P: people, platforms, power, and partnerships. First is people. And forgive me, Master Chief, but we have the best force we've ever had today. And it's up to us to keep it that way. But we have put them under a lot of stress. We've expected a lot from them. Our operational tempo is incredibly high. We're away from families more and more. And so we're changing the way we manage the force. We're doing things like promote based on merit versus on year group. We don't have enough women in the Navy, and we don't keep enough women in the Navy. So 3 weeks ago, acting under authority given me, I tripled paid maternity leave for people in the Navy and the Marines from 6 weeks to 18 weeks. We're making sure that dual military families, to the extent we can, are co-located and that they don't deploy at the same time. I've extended child care hours, 2 hours earlier in the morning, 2 hours later at night. And every major base has at least one 24-hour child care facility. We lose too many women. Our force ought to reflect the country that we defend. And so we're trying to make this easier. We're trying to keep people from making a choice. And Congress, I'm going to ask you for some help. I can do the maternity leave, but for partners, it's only 10 days of leave. And Congress has to change that. Fathers and partners ought to be a part of that child's life also. And for adoptive parents, they only get 21 days. And if it's a dual military family, only one can take that. We ought to do better than that. platforms. We're here today because of that. Quantity has a quality all its own. And in 2001, on 9/11, the U.S. Navy had 316 ships. By 2008, we were down to 278 ships. And we were involved in two land wars. There was a reason for this. But in the 5 years prior to 2009, we only put 27 ships under contract. That wasn't enough to keep these shipyards open, and it wasn't enough to keep our fleet from declining. In my first 5 years, we put 70 ships under contract. And we did it with a smaller top line, and we did it because of places like Marinette, where the cost of the LCS has been cut by more than half, thanks to the work we've done together, thanks to the great shipbuilders here, thanks to the management team from Fincantieri and Lockheed. And I'll use one other platform as a quick example. The Navy last summer signed the biggest contract in our history for 10 Virginia-class submarines, over a $17 billion contract. We're getting 10. We paid for 9. It's like having one of those punch cards. Buy 10 submarines, buy 9 submarines, get your 10th one free. We'll be back at 304 ships by the end of this decade. And we will stay there. Because if you miss a year in shipbuilding, you never make it up, ever. We're living with the fleet size today because of decisions made 15, 20 years ago. The fleet that we have 15 to 20 years from now depends on the decisions we make today. Third, power, energy. All you have to do is look at what Russia is doing to the Ukraine, what Russia did to Crimea, what Russia is doing to Europe, to see how fuel and energy can be used as a weapon. We cannot allow that to be used as a weapon against us. So we are moving toward alternative sources of fuel. By the end of this year, half of our fuel, half of our energy, a gigawatt's worth on our bases, will come from alternative sources. That's 5 years ahead of schedule. And by 2020, half of all our operational energy at sea for ships like Little Rock will come from alternative sources, so that fuel cannot be used against us as a weapon. And finally, partnerships. We have three crucial types of partnerships. One is with shipbuilders and industry. And this partnership has allowed us to build Little Rock. It's allowed us to build the amazing Navy that we have today and the fleet that is coming. And I cannot say enough, as Joe Malloy pointed out, about the shipbuilders here at Marinette, about the ones at Austell, about the ones around the country building the various naval ships, and about those that support them. The second partnership is with our international partners. I have now been to 140 separate countries and territories as secretary, and we're doing something with every one of these. I go primarily to see sailors and Marines where they are, forward deployed, instead of waiting back at the Pentagon just on the off chance they'll stop by and see me. But the other thing is to engage with these international partners. And finally, is our partnership with the American people. We're America's away team. When we're doing our job, we're usually a long, long way from home. And it's ceremonies like this. It's names like Little Rock. It's sponsors like Janae Bonner that connect the American people to their Navy, to their Marine Corps, to the people protected, to the people doing the protecting. Now to Little Rock. You've heard the history of Little Rock, built in 45, finished two months before the end of World War II, decommissioned in 49, then brought back into service at the beginning of the Cold War, reconfigured. The Afghans were taken off, the deckhouse was taken off, and nuclear-capable Talos missiles were installed. They also cut out a chunk of the amidships, put this huge antenna up. It did not give the Little Rock a beautiful profile, but it made her a very powerful ship. She was involved in a whole lot of things. Flagship of the Sixth Fleet, went to the aid when the USS Liberty was strafed accidentally by the Israelis in the 67 war, was the command ship for that, for us in the 67 Arab-Israeli conflict. Off the coast of Santo Domingo to reassure. And today, CLG-4, CG-92, the first Little Rock, lies at anchor in the harbor in Buffalo, New York. I'm leaving here to go to Buffalo. And we are, as you've heard, live streaming this primarily to Little Rock, to Austell, but also to Buffalo for those sailors that sailed on first USS Little Rock. Little Rock has had some amazing people who served on it. James E. Williams, the most decorated enlisted sailor in U.S. Navy history, served on Little Rock. Medal of Honor recipient, Navy Cross, 2 Silver Stars. Carl Mundy, future Commandant of the Marine Corps, served aboard Little Rock. Captain Frank Caldwell, United States Marine Corps, Navy Cross recipient at Iwo Jima, served aboard Little Rock. And a very scruffy, terrible beard, Lieutenant J.G. showed up in 1970 and joined the crew of the USS Little Rock. Whatever success I've had in life, I owe so much of it to what I learned on that ship and from people like Master Chief Mutzabal. We are extremely fortunate to have as the sponsor of Little Rock. I mean, I've got the coolest job in the world. I get to name Navy ships, and naming the second USS Little Rock because I served on the first one is an absolute coincidence, I can assure you of that. But I also get to name sponsors. And I have to tell you, it is no accident that the sponsor of a Freedom Class variant, built in Marionette, is a native of Mobile, where we build the other variant. This is 2 variants, but 1 program. Janae Bonner, ties those 2 great communities, 2 great shipbuilders together. This LCS program, I think it's fair to say, got off to a bumpy start. But it's been said before, once we got the ships in the water and you see what they do, the Fort Worth, the Freedom, the Independence at RIMPAC last year, those questions have begun to subside. Janae Bonner, sponsor of the Little Rock, Native of Mobile, graduate of Rhodes College in Memphis, lived in D.C. for 12 years and then returned home. And it's been a force, an absolute force in her community, regardless of whether that was Washington or Mobile or now Tuscaloosa. Too many civic responsibilities to mention. President of the Junior League and on the board of the Episcopal School there, on the board of United Way, and on and on and on. Her husband, Joe, I think it is fair to say that the odds of LCS surviving would not have been as great without Joe Bonner. And he's not here today because he's taking their younger son, or their younger child, Robbins, on a college visit today. He's a senior in high school, and I know how important that is. And the only thing, Joe, you're taking him to the Air Force Academy today. Really? We've got a school right down the road. So I know people there. Bring him to Annapolis next. Janae Bonner, a civic leader, a wonderful sponsor, will infuse the new USS Little Rock with her spirit, her determination, her graciousness. So from the Navy, semper fortis, always courageous. From the Marines, semper fidelis, always faithful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I was going to introduce Mrs. Bonner, but I think the Secretary did a great job of that. What do you think? Our sponsors.
Thank you to everyone for the opportunity to be here. This is just a beautiful day, an exciting day. And I just want to comment that when the USS Little Rock deploys, she and her crew will become the newest member of a fleet that the world looks to and depends on for the defense of liberty and aspirations of hope and freedom. Throughout the centuries, the brave men and women who have been on station when a crisis develops have stood tall. Their willingness to make the ultimate sacrifice is a testament to their love of something bigger than oneself. But before the crew takes command of this wonderful new instrument for peace, I would be remiss as the ship's sponsor in not thanking all of the hardworking, dedicated men and women who have brought this beautiful ship to life, the craftsmen and masters of your trade from Think and Terry, Marinette Marine, Lockheed Martin, and so many other companies, both large and small, who have played an integral role in helping to build one of the great new ships that will sail the seas. As you all know, as you all know better than anyone, there are so many people who work long days and late nights, often behind the scenes and out of the spotlight, because you know the success of your mission will enable the sailors of the USS Little Rock to successfully perform their mission. Thank you for what you have done to deliver the USS Little Rock into the hands of a grateful nation. May God bless you all as you continue your talented and dedicated work, and may God always watch over the crew of the USS Little Rock and every mission she undertakes. Thank you.
It's time to christen the vessel, but before we do, I'd like the chaplain to come up and give us a benediction.
Please stand and join me in prayer. Gracious and everlasting God, We gather today to partake in one of our Navy's oldest traditions, christening the USS Little Rock and invoking your presence and blessing upon it. We rejoice in this magnificent achievement, the ingenuity and craft you have instilled in every person that followed in your image to create. May all who have been faithful in service from concept to the presence of this ship before us rest with great satisfaction today. This mighty ship will brave the forces of the high seas, the powerful winds, and often maneuvering among treacherous waters. Protect it. The sailors serving on board will brave the forces that continuously fight against our nation and mission. Protect them. Grant the USS Little Rock and all the crew that shall serve on board an unwavering resiliency to remain victorious through challenging deployments and special missions in devoted service to our freedom. May this ship always reflect the standard of excellence that we see in the namesake of Little Rock. May the spirit we see in the city of Little Rock likewise be properly represented as a ship that stands proud above surrounding waters. We offer this ship to your care, asking your hands to uphold in the uttermost parts of the sea for divine blessings to abound on the journey this ship and crew shall venture to in the near and distant future. We ask and pray this in your holy name. Amen.
So at this point, please be seated. We're going to now begin the christening ceremony. So Jan and Joe, would you please escort Mrs. Bonner and Secretary Mabus to the platform, please? Marinette Marine. While we're waiting for the people to walk over there, I'd like one opportunity to have every single worker that works on this ship, please raise your hand to show everybody out there who you are. Okay, at this time, I'd like the platform guests to move forward to the viewing area. Launch team, please take your places. Audience members are now invited to move forward into the designated areas. Mrs. Bonner, are you ready to christen and launch this great vessel?
For the United States of America, I christen thee the Little Rock. May God bless this ship and all who sail in her.
What a great launch. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our ceremony. Please view the ship and then exit the yard.